Welcome back, Scott.
Thanks, Ian.
You know, in today's episode, we have two guests. Manfred Myers returns, and he's brought along Jason Johnson, Vice President of Business Development at Tech River. Tech River helps clients navigate the ever-changing flow of technology. Their focus on customer service, IT enablement, and cybersecurity makes them a standout in the IT services and the consulting space. Welcome, Jason. Glad to have you on the channel.
Thanks, Ian.
Absolutely. You know, last week we discussed the importance of clearly defined SOPs, leadership training in LLMs, and assessing an organization's culture's readiness in AI adoption. Cybersecurity and protecting proprietary data were also critical discussion points. Scott shared practical applications of AI on the shop floor, and I encouraged executives to seek support, positioning the team as a reliable partner in the AI journey. Jason, with your background in cybersecurity, what advice would you give executive leaders on protecting internal documents and data?
Yeah, thanks, Ian. So in my recent newsletter, I shared a pretty eye-opening stat, which is that about half of employees out there have access to way more data than they actually need. So when I start talking with business leaders, I usually begin by asking just one simple question. Do you know exactly who in your company has access to that critical data right now? Most people pause because the honest answer is typically no. Now, the real issue isn't that people are doing anything malicious, it's just that mistakes happen. So someone moves departments, they take on a new project, they might even leave the company, and their access just keeps building up. So that's something that we call privilege creep. And over time, that really creates a big insider risk. Now, the best way to fix this is what we call least privilege principle. So basically, we only want to give people access to the data they need to do their job and nothing more. And if they need something temporarily above that access, you want to utilize a tool that provides just-in-time access. So it grants that access for a short period of time, but then it removes it after it's no longer needed. So look, this isn't really about slowing down your team. It's about protecting your business, your customers, and ultimately your reputation. Because at the end of the day, you can't protect what you don't know exists. So leaders really want to start by reviewing who has access to what data and then tightening it up before it becomes a problem.
Great point. Love it.
Yeah, good answer. My question's for Manny. Manny, how does what Jason said apply to the shop floor for operations managers? See, in my line of work, when making improvements, I often bring in consultants or contractors. I want their help with AI, but I also need them to meet FDA regulatory requirements and maintain confidentiality. What is your take on managing that?
Well, first of all, thanks again for having me in this episode here. So good question. So the first line of defense when it comes to documents in operations and data access is to limit the documents that you send to your suppliers and consultants. And Jason covered that very well and explained why that is. For example, if you have a machine shop that is making a sub-assembly for you, don't send them the whole technical file with the full product specification. Only send them the CAD files that they need to make the part and the specification for that. But we all know that companies sometimes need to share proprietary information and proprietary documents with their suppliers and consultants. Otherwise, they can't do the job. Now, when we talk to the regulated industry, the FDA requires medical device manufacturers, and I'm going to read that here, what's in the standard, establish and maintain procedures to ensure that all purchased or otherwise received products and services conform to specific requirements. So that's part of the Federal Code of Regulation in 21 CFR 820.50. So what does that mean? It means that evaluating and qualifying suppliers is based on their ability to meet regulatory and quality requirements, establishing quality agreements and documented expectations, and verifying then the deliverables that they meet the requirements and before you can use them in a regulated system. So, when you apply that to AI services, this expectation must evolve. instead of looking at a sterilization certificate or a calibration records from your suppliers, medtech organizations now must evaluate, do the AI consultants understand the regulated frameworks? So FDA, MDR, etc. Transparency and traceability of the tools that they use, the AI tools, and the data sets. Where are the data stored? So security and location of the underlying infrastructure, especially when we talk about cloud-based designs and LLMs, what we talked about last week. AI consultants, AI platforms are now effective suppliers, and they must be treated as suppliers as part of the quality system. Unfortunately, as of now, a few medical device companies apply the same rigor that they use for contract manufacturers or test lab to AI suppliers. So in my article about why medtech companies need SOPs for AI consultants and tools, I dive deeper into the major risk that this gap creates and what an AI supplier SOP should include.